If someone grabs you around the neck or stuffs something down your throat to stop you from breathing, that is a crime under New Zealand's new family violence law. Strangulation, often referred to by victims as choking, is common in New Zealand. The research shows that when someone strangles you, you're in danger of being killed. If someone strangles you or someone that you know, call police.
Okay, that's one of the government's new ads just released tonight, which explain the new family violence laws that come into force tomorrow. Green MP Jan Logie is also the Justice Under-Secretary on domestic and sexual violence issues, and she joins me now. Jan. Minister, well, Under-Secretary, this pretty hard-hitting ads, but a very important issue. We've got a shocking record on domestic violence. Are you confident that these changes will make a substantial difference, get that awful rate down?
They're part of our response, and we know that we have a lot of work to do. At the moment, 1 million New Zealanders are directly affected by family violence, and that we know that too many, particularly women and children, are dying as a result of this violence, and we need to come together to turn that round, and we can.
And the strangulation, so the change with strangulation which comes into force from tomorrow, talk to me about that, because that's very important. It's a separate charge or separate crime?
It's a new offence. So the legislation that comes into force tomorrow will create three new criminal offences. So the first one is of strangulation, will have a maximum penalty of 7 years. And the second is coercion to marry, which will have a maximum offence of 5 years. And that's because there was a gap in our response to coercion to marry with. We didn't actually.
We're not talking about arranged marriage here.
We are not talking arranged marriage. It's when there's people do not freely consent. You can freely consent to arranged marriage. That's how that works. So this is a separate thing. And then the third thing is a family violence offence, so that we can start tracking family violence. Up till now, we've only had abuse of children and male assaults female, which has been our proxy, clearly is inappropriate if you think about same-sex relationships and sibling
violence. So we were missing a lot of the stats.
We were missing the stats, and we actually had an uneven response. So this evens it up. So male assaults female will remain on the books, so we can track the gendered nature of the violence, but also now we'll be able to track some of the other forms of family violence.
The UN committee on this stuff, I think you had to go and front up, and New Zealand's record's not great. Do you think you will be able to go back to the UN and show some, demonstrate some improvements? So where are the, how else will you try and turn these around?
So I've personally been working on these issues for decades. My first proper job was working for Women's Refuge, and I'm absolutely committed to us doing everything we can as a government, and the government is right behind.
Can you get the money that is needed for the investment in those frontline services?
It was really pleasing to me that one of the very first actions of the government was putting more money into our frontline family violence services. We know we still need to put more to our sexual violence services because they are really struggling at the moment. But we've also, so we've passed the Domestic Violence Victims Protection Bill, which will provide up to 10 days leave for victims from work to help them stay in employment, give them a pathway to safety. New legislation, which was a private members bill started by Dr. Jackie Blue around court consent for the marriages of 16 and 17 year olds, recognising another dynamic of family violence. There's this new legislation, and there's a joint venture, which a terrible name, it's a working title, but it's bringing together a whole of government response to family violence where we will get everyone on the same page and build a lot more of prevention.
Right. And is this because one of the issues is sometimes people don't always know the right place to go, you know, that there are issues around, you know, different departments working on different things?
There's so many problems, actually. It's been described the Family Violence Death Review Committee has really been calling us out for years now for having a fragmented and effective response. So what we're trying to do is make sure that we do everything we can to prevent the violence in the first place and intervene as early as possible so things don't escalate. And then when victims are telling us, and they're often telling friends, family, workmates, doctors, counsellors, a lot of times, or teachers.
Sure.
And they're not getting the help that they need when they make those disclosures.
So make those pathways easier.
Yeah, exactly. So that whoever you tell knows what to do to actually wrap around and give you the support that you need, and that we shift our focus from holding victims responsible for their own safety, which is pretty much business as usual at the moment, to actually saying, this person who's choosing to use violence, you can change, and we're going to wrap around you to stop you using violence again, because you don't need to and you shouldn't, and you'll be held accountable, and we'll support you to change so that you can have great relationships.
All right, let's move on to a different topic, the issue of bullying at Parliament. We're hearing a lot about that at the moment, allegations against an MP, Maggie Barry, which she denies of bullying, but what is your thoughts on this review that of bullying at Parliament?
Well, just to be clear, this comment is from my perspective as a Green Party MP rather than a government person with a role in the executive, because we have to keep those things separate. So I'm really welcome this independent review. It's really important that we know that sexual harassment and bullying are more likely in workplaces where there is power differences. And Parliament is certainly one of those
In your experience, have you witnessed bullying when you've been an MP?
Absolutely. I think I remember years ago...
What does that look like, though?
One of the examples, when I worked years ago for the YWCA, we took a team of peer mediators from Wellington High into school, into Parliament, to audit Parliament on their school code of conduct. We're looking at kind of non-violence. And honestly, most of us would be in detention the whole time if we were in a school, if we behaved like we do in a school.
But is high-pressure environment, people, yelling at a staff member because they're upset with some work or something, is that bullying?
That's unacceptable.
What?
Everybody should be able to come to work and be treated with respect and to feel safe. I think, and it's not about saying that everyone's going to get it right all of the time, but that we need to create a culture where if somebody kind of under the stress of something reacts badly, that actually then they know to apologise, and that we don't have that as a norm in any office or space within our workplace.
All right, before we go, I just want to ask you for your thoughts on an issue which has been raging, which is around transgender rights. Yeah. There's been some media column, Rachel Stewart wrote one, very controversial, in which a number of people attacked her for having a view around transgender rights, the ability of transgenders people to declare themselves as women. Mm. It's upset some women. It's a very complex area. Should Rachel Stewart and others be allowed to say what they say?
I've just got to say, I mean, I find this debate really sad. In 2007, the Human Rights Commission did a comprehensive review around the rights of transgender people in New Zealand. They found conclusively that being trans was not a lifestyle choice. It was a natural part of human diversity. We've had non-binary identities from the beginning of time. In New Zealand, Taka Tapui, in the Pacific, Whaafene, Whakaleti, Mahu, so many.
Sure.
This has been around forever.
I guess the issue is, the debate seems to be whether the likes of Rachel Stewart should even be able to say that. And then they, of course, are arguing, well, it's free speech. Mm. And what's confusing for people sitting back and watching is going, well, hang on, you can't even say that?
Well, so my concern is, and I would say to people who are looking at questioning, if they don't understand the realities of human diversity, then go and do some reading and some research and really... This is the most marginalised community in our country, really high rates of self-harm and suicide. Take a do-no-harm approach. We've got to make sure that we are not persecuting or undermining people's existence through, our exploration of ideas.
Jan Logie, thank you very much for your time. We appreciate it on Q&A.